طيب، أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم سبحانك سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا صالحا وفهما في الدين. يا فتاح يا عليم، يا فتاح يا عليم، افتح علينا فتحا قريبا يا فتاح يا عليم، واجعلنا لك من المتقربين بوسيلة المتقربين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم، واجعلنا لك من عبادك الصالحين ذاكرين شاكرين صالحين صادقين منيبين مفلحين توابين متطهرين يا رب العالمين. نوينا التعلم والتعليم والتذكر والتذكير والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وسنة رسوله ودعاء إلى الهدى ودلالة على الخير وابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. To one and all, back to the Tafsir and Tasawwuf, that being Tafsir of Imam al-Baghawi, in which we enter into Surah Al-Imran, as well as the Tasawwuf aspects of beautifying character, led by none other than Hujjatul Islam, Sayyiduna Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahumullah, wa nafa'na bihim ajma'in. And we begin with the texts again, and as per usual with the Quran and the tafsir of Al-Quran al-Karim, tafsir of Imam al-Baghawi. Qabla dhalik, we obviously take the khair and the barakah from by commemorating from our mother and commemorating our beloved mother, as was her passing a few days ago. None other than the one who was the bid'ah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our beloved mother and leader of the women of Jannah, Sayyida Fatima radiallahu anha. Allah grant us the benefit and khair and barakah from her, and send our peace and blessings and salutation and most humble submission to her radiallahu anha wa anhum ajma'in. Bisirri asrar al-Fatiha ila Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra radiallahu anha al-Fatiha. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين يا رب العالمين. ف we begin with the text. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب منه آيات محكمات هن أم الكتاب وأخر متشابهات فأما الذين في قلوبهم زيغ فيتبعون ما تشابه منه ابتغاء الفتنة وابتغاء تأويله وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله والراسخون في العلم يقولون آمنا به كل من عند ربنا وما يذكر إلا أولو الألباب ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا إنك جامع الناس ليوم لا ريب فيه إن الله لا يخلف الميعاد. صدق الله مولانا العظيم. الآية number 8. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We spoke about in آية number 7 last, the rasikhun, those people who are thubut and in the deen and in their belief in Allah and the surety of Allah Jalla Jalaluhu, they were called ar-rasikhun, like mountains. They were firm and established in their deen and in their belief of tawheed. So they go on to say, الراسخون, that is, as the mufassir says, قوله تعالى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا أي ويقولون الراسخون ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا. The راسخون, the people who are established in their faith and with their iman and in the monotheism of Allah, Allah Jalla Jalal being the one and only absolutely unique. They are the راسخون, established and firm. They say, ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا. Oh Allah, don't allow that our hearts experience, in the Arabic language it's called mail away from an inclination. Mail an is an inclination away. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا. Do not allow our hearts to be distracted. Do not allow our hearts to experience being drawn to or experience any magnetization or any force that attracts us to other than you. بعد إذ هديتنا. The is meaning it had already happened. Surety that it's already happened in the Madi, that is in the past. So after you, O Allah, after you have guided us, لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا. After you have guided us, do not allow our hearts to turn back and experience the experience of having been drawn away from you or being distracted rather from you. Jalla Jalaluhu. Remember, قَالَ الرَّاسِخُونَ. As though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, it's the rasikhun basically who are actually only able to make this dua of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something of such great weight, is that they needed to be a rasikhun in the first place, as is of the opinion of some of the mufassirin here. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا. Also not forgetting that بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا, that hidayah was a tawfiq from Allah Jalla Jalaluhu, that being the tawfiq from Allah Jalla Jalaluhu being gifted and granted the guidance. For everyone knows that there is ilm kasbiyah and ilm wahbiyah, and items and actions and so on that are kasbiyah and wahbiyah. Kasbiyah being that which you earn, and the wahbiyah is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just gives of his generosity and so on and so forth. Not forgetting in the bigger picture that if someone attributes to themselves kasb and having acquired a thing and so on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above all things. All wahb and kasb anyway is wahbiyah from Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Wa ba'da thalik. Rabbana innaka jami'un nasi liyawmin la rayba fih. Inna Allah la yukhliful mi'ad. Is that, oh Allah, you are the one who gathers. Yawm al-Hashr, the yawm of where things are gathered, the yawm al-Nashr wal-Hashr and so on, where things are gathered, spread out, etc. and so on and so forth. In that they say, Rabbana innaka jami'un nasi liyawmin la rayba fih. You are the one, ya Rabbal Alameen. You are the one that gathers people on that day. You are the one that makes jam of everyone on that day. On which day? On the day that? ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ رَيْبَ فِيهِ لِيَوْمِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. You are the one that gathers everyone together on a day in which there is no doubt, Ya رب العالمين. And again, this reflects back to the nature of someone who is راسخ. Someone who is راسخ being completely and fully established. It's fully and established within them to the point that they have no shak, no doubt, full and complete certainty in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and obviously the last day and so on and so forth. And thus they're able to make this dua. The rasikhun can make this dua saying لِيَوْمِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, in a date in which in a day you are the one who gathers, on a day in which there's absolutely no doubt. Ya Allah, as though they are saying, Ya Allah, because we have no doubt upon that. We believe you, we believe in you and your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and on the last day about which there is no doubt. Wallahu a'lam. Inna Allah la yukhliful mi'ad. So I would really like to ride on the point that the rasikhun have absolute and complete surety. They're not confused or have no doubt either about the last day. They don't say, maybe we accept, maybe we refuse, and so on and so forth, as was with some of the Yahud and the Nasara, a part of them, in which they said, we'll take this part and we leave that part, and you know, we work with this, but we don't really like that, so we leave it like that, and so on and so forth. Here they are rasikhun, they are firm, they are established in يوم لا ريب فيه, as well as إن الله لا يخلف الميعاد. They have full and complete tawakkul in Allah, because they fully trust and fully know for sure within themselves that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not go back on His word. لا يخلف الميعاد جل جلاله. وقوله تعالى إن بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين كفروا لن تغني عنهم أموالهم ولا أولادهم من الله شيئا وأولئك هم وقود النار. Those who disbelieved, or not only disbelieved but denied the signs of Allah, the ayat of Allah, the prophets of Allah, the message of Allah, the sha'air Allah, and so on and so forth, لن تغني عنهم أموالهم ولا أولادهم. From previous days and from previous times in history, all the way up to now, and inshallah till the end of history, progeny has always been the sort of pride horse upon which people tend to boast about what they have, and so on and so forth. If it's not the money, then it's the progeny, and so on. Be it in tribal societies or out of tribal societies, it's always a case of people expressing that so much through either the mal or the amwal. It's their monies and their wealth and their riches, and their progeny then is also another channel altogether for boasting and for basically having haughtiness and so on. And thus you'll often notice that people begin to believe that these are the things that would bail them out when they're sort of in trouble or answerable in any way, because this is all they really ever had to deal with. This is all they ever really focused on. This is all they ever really worked with in the entire beings as themselves. And thus they're somewhat tricked or deluded into believing that this is their point of strength, when it was not actually their point of strength, but rather only a thing that gave them worldly gain and not gain in the Akhirah. And thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just confirms again for them who are the deniers, لا تغني عنهم أموالهم ولا أولادهم من الله. من الله. So the amwal and the abna and so on, the progeny and the money and so on and so forth, and worldly possessions might work a little bit in the dunya, but من الله, Allah is beyond the dunya. For He's the creator of the dunya, the eternally everlasting. So when we go beyond just the dunya, Allah says none of their monies nor their children or their offspring will save them from Allah, apart from Allah. They have absolutely nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save them, and that also from a different angle, to save them from Allah Himself, Jalla Jalaluhu. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ وَقُودُ النَّارِ. And these people who believe this kind of thing, who have this kind of delusion and this waham, and they basically, subhanAllah, people tend to live within this, and this sort of an intoxication that they have ways and means out through sort of partnerships that other than the close relations with Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stamps them and confirms them as the fuel for the fire. وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَٰلِكَ كَدَأْبِ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. As was the behavior of Fir'aun and people from before him and so on, كَمِثْلِ قَوْمْ عَاد وَثَمُود and so on and so forth. It's this kind of mentality and behavior, and thus behavior, obviously your certain understanding and your mentality will affect the behavior of many people. So if you want to see the kind of ilm that people have, especially in the times that we're currently in, Allah protect us and grant us good conduct, is that you'll notice people who don't really have much ilm, and people who actually truly have ilm are the people who display the best of conduct. And you will see that especially in the situation that we find ourselves in times as of recent. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, and protect us and grant us the most beautiful character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and teach us how to emulate him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. كذبوا بآياتنا فأخذهم الله بذنوبهم. They had lied. They had not only just played in denying, but by denying they had gone ahead and lied and so on. بِآيَاتِنَا فَأَخَذَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِذُنُوبِهِمْ فَأَعْقَبَهُمُ اللَّهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had apportioned for them the consequences of what they had done by denying and lying and belying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his ayat. It's very interesting here. We've spoken about the ayat last week as well, the ayat of Allah and so on. And this is how people are to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I've mentioned in last week's session, if you go to Surah Ar-Rum, it's on the first on the first or the second page, depending on the Mus'haf that you read. You know, there are quite a few of them mentioned there, apart from everywhere else in Al-Quran Al-Kareem. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, wa min ayatihi an khalaqakum min turabin thumma idha antum basharun tantashirun, and so on and so forth. There are another few after that. Is that the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what allows us to connect and realize the grandeur of Allah and understand how we would never actually completely understand Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here says that كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا. They had belied our ayat. They had denied our ayat. They had to make kufr of the ayat, meaning they had to deny the ayat. And thus, they made kadhb. They belied our ayat, and they belied our ayat, and thus they could never connect to Allah Jalla Jalaluhu, and thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had taken them to task with the consequences of those things, them being waqudun nar, the fuel of the fire, and so on and so forth. فَأَخَذَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِذُنُوبِهِمْ وَاللَّهُ شَدِيدُ الْإِقَابِ. قُلْ لِلَّذِينَ قُلْ Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, قُلْ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَتُغْلَبُونَ وَتُحْشَرُونَ إِلَى جَهَنَّمْ. Allah. And we've just mentioned just now, it will be the day of Hashr, Yawmul Hashr, the Yawm of Gathering. The Yawm of Gathering, the ayah here was, the word was, Jami'. رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ جَامِعُ النَّاسِ. Jami'u an-nas, you make hashr of all of the nas, ya Rabb al-alamin, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, tell them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kulli alladhina kafaru, the deniers, the liars, satughlabuna wa tuhsharuna ila jahannama. You will be gathered and you will be overcome and you will be taken to the hellfire in your gathering, when you're made a gathering, ila jahannama wa bi'sal mihad. Qad kana lakum ayatun في فئتين التقتا. Allah. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ آيَةٌ. And for you all was, and كَانَ لَكُمْ آيَةٌ في فئتين التقتا. In two groups. Two groups in which you are two flanks. You are separated. Different groups. People will be grouped. People, though everyone will be on Yawm al-Qiyamah, the Yawm al-Hashr will be gathered and so on, but you will be taken into the groups. And again, as discussed also in the Bidayatul Hidayah of Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, is that we said that, he said, rahimahullah, that there are seven doors to the Jahannam, and you enter through the door that is linked to one of the seven limbs, in which Imam al-Ghazali says that you would be entering Jannah through the door of the dedicated of the limb which you used the most, also to be in the ma'asi of Allahu Jalla Jalaluhu. And here we see that again here, in that people are categorized, flanks are made, groups are made, people will be separated and so on and so forth. And with this we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst the group that are not only the Muslimin and the Mu'mineen and Muhsineen, but make us from amongst the group that stand next to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and stand behind Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and from amongst the group whom Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is granted his shafa'ah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. وأخرى كافرة. I just want to see what all we're referring to here further. في فئتين التقتا وأخرى كافرة. And the ayah goes on to speak about here about some of the Battle of Badr, and here's also what some of the Mufassireen mentioned, is that these are actually referring to the different groups of the people that had attended the Ghazwa, بدر في فئتين التقتا وأخرى كافرة يرونهم مثل وأخرى كافرة يرونهم مثليهم رأي العين. In which the kuffar were so deceived and so they were so deluded that they had been seeing double and so on and so forth in order to create it. It's a mu'ajiza and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had granted the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the mu'mineen at the time, that would delude the kafirun into believing that they were a lot, or seeing that they were a lot and so on and so forth, creating fear obviously within the enemies. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obviously finishes that ayah with وَاللَّهُ يُؤَيِّدُ بِنَصْرِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. Subhanallah wa bihamdi. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is something I think that will resonate with us a lot in this Ramadan period, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make that a reality. وَاللَّهُ يُؤَيِّدُ بِنَصْرِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يُؤَيِّدُ aids directly divine intervention with victory, whoever he wills. And even though this is in a different context, we ourselves find ourselves in a constant battle of being in this dunya at all times. And this is actually our time and our time of a little bit of respite to re-armor and enable ourselves and get our ducks in a row and really get ourselves ready for all guns blazing for when we get out of the Ramadan, because we all know that this is the time in which we also receive the aid and of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the powering up by reconnecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What a beautiful month it is. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obviously says here, وَاللَّهُ يُؤَيِّدُ بِنَصْرِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ, is that he helps and grants full assistance onto complete victory whom he pleases, Jalla Jalaluhu. And again, at the moment we're in the Ramadan, the door is open to all of us. إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. Again, it's a time of the Ramadan now. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ, in that is clarification. In that is a lesson for the people of, to the people who are able to see. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a Ramadan and a time after Ramadan until we meet Him Jalla Jalal Yawm Al-Qiyamah. That we take the ibrah at all times, and we be from amongst al-ulil abasar at all times. Amina ya rabbal alamin. Wa qawluhu ta'ala zuyyina lin-nasi hubbu shahawat. Allah, this is a very big ayah actually. Again, reflects back to an ayah that we discussed just now. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنْطَرَةِ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ وَالْخَيْلِ الْمُسَوَّمَةِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ وَالْحَرْثِ ذَلِكَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says again about the dunya. Notice we have not in a chaotic way, but we have a lot of back and forth and back and forth, as though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us examples of nur dhulum, nur dhulum, light darkness, light darkness. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala varies the ayahs in this pattern, and here we go back to a reminder of what draws you into the dhulam. Zuyyina linnasi hubbu shahawati. In the Arabic language, it comes from zayn or zayyana or zina, is that there's beautification of these things. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Zuyyina linnasi hubbu shahawati minan nisa wal banin wal qanatir, and so on and so forth. Is that zuyyina linnas. And we know that there's a thing called zinatul dunya. وَزِينَةُ حَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, is that the dunya in its entirety had experienced zina. Is that the dunya in its entirety had to be beautified. And I'd just like to take a step back for a moment and let us think about it and ask ourselves, since when is it that something fully and completely beautiful needed more beautification? You know, and thus there's an ishara, an inshari meaning here, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He's beautified things. In other parts of the Quran, we find that the dunya in its entirety has been beautified. Here, in its specific things are mentioned, which they have experienced, the act of beautification in specific. But remember that something fully and completely beautiful, in its true being and in its true form and in its true essence, never needed to be beautified in the first place. And a full and complete proof of this is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi, the full and completely most beautiful being and full and completely most beautiful creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the kind of beauty that we've never been able to encompass, and the kind of beauty and true beauty that we never will be able to encompass. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to experience that kind of beauty in states of wakefulness and in sleep. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you in the Ishari meaning here, Zuyyina, made beautiful. It was not really beautiful in the first place, truly in itself, but it had been made beautiful by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, made beautiful that you may be deluded by it again, if not connected to Him Jalla Jalaluhu. Zuyyina linnasi hubbu shahawat. Made beautiful in the dunya is not necessarily even the shahawat, but made beautiful, it's so lowly, the shahawat and these things to come, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made beautiful not them in themselves, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautified loving these things, having a hub for these things. Hubbu shahawati minan nisa wal banin, and so on and so forth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here telling you, made beautiful to all people, linnas, is even the one of the mufassirin here mentioned zuyina linnas. The linnas here is basically it's an arm reference, an army reference, referring to sort of many in specific, but it does have a bit of a general meaning to it as well. Wallahu a'lam. Zuyyina linnasi, made beautiful for annas, is hubbu shahawat, not the shahawat, but hubbu shahawat. And thus a lot of people ask, you know, but it's a natural tendency to sort of desire this, and it's a natural tendency to have those desires and want to fulfill our desires and so on and so forth. That being of women and possessions and wealth, money and so on and so forth. And I think it's very important for us to realize with the way the structure of the ayah is here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarifies fully and completely that it's the hub of these things. It's not that you're not allowed to have your few shahawat, but it's your hub and your deep intense love for fulfilling your desires that will actually draw you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For this is the dunya, this is how the dunya has been wired and created. Zuyyina linnas, made beautiful for annas, is the love of the desires, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, of minan nisa, from women, and from again progeny and so on. Wal khayl al musawwamati wal an'ami wal harth, of the gold and the silver, and the khayl al musawwamati wal an'ami wal harth. Remember and bear in mind that this is referring to the horses and so on and so forth. Obviously, at the time of the Arabs, what would appeal most to them is to speak to what obviously resonates with them. And while they might not have had the huge mansions and so on that we have nowadays, they had them in their own, within their own respects. And basically the Lamborghinis and the Ferraris and so on and so forth of those days were beautiful horses and these kinds of possessions. Wallahu ta'ala a'alam. ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ الْعَظِيمُ. ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, that is only an enjoyment of the dunya. It's just fully and completely an enjoyment of the dunya and the dunya only. It does not go on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the eternal with no beginning, everlasting with no end. Everlasting with no end. Why? And why do we harp on about this point? Because Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Surah Ar-Rahman, chapter number 55, Kullu man alayha fan, ويبقى وجه ربك ذي الجلال والإكرام. Is that everything on it will perish. It's made to perish. Every single thing, including yourselves and myself, is created with an expiry date, will expire, will diminish on its way to expiring, and eventually will expire. Wallahu a'lam. Wallahu عنده حسن المآب. وقوله تعالى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل أنبئكم بخير من ذلكم أي أخبركم بخير من ذلكم للذين اتقوا عند ربهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها أزواج مطهرة ورضوان من الله والله بصير بالعباد. Say to them, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, should I not tell you about what is good from all of these things for you? Good for those people who have had taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have had a consciousness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, conscious presence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِلَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. Is that for them, dedicated for them and kept especially for them in al-akhirah, of course, is Jannatun, gardens beneath which rivers flow, khalidina fiha, and they would remain in there forever. It's an eternity. Wa azwajun mutahharatun wa ridwanun min Allah. And for them are fair companions for both men and women, and so on and so forth. Fair companions, eternal companions that are pure in their nature, pure in their nature. They speak no foul, they do no foul. They have never experienced foul, and so on and so forth. And this is the companionship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised the people of taqwa and the people who believe in Him, Jalla Jalaluhu. Wa ridwanun min Allah. And this is probably the greatest of them all, is the ridwan of Allah, the sheer pleasure of Allah, and the sheer pleasure granted to them from Allah Jalla Jalaluhu, eternal and full and complete bliss with no return. With no kullu man alayha fan, upon the bliss that they experience and the pleasure that they experience. Not to mention that some of the ulama and the mufassirin and so on have come to conclusions that it's an ever increasing pleasure and an ever increasing amusement that never ever diminishes and rather only goes up and increases in its sort of weight, really, and in experience, really. Wallahu a'lam. Wallahu basirun bil ibad. Alladhina yaquluna rabbana innana amanna faghfir lana dhunubana wa qina adhaban nar. And here that some of the Mufassirin have then said is that this also goes back to Ar-Rasikhun, possibly so, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, is that Alladhina yaquluna Rasikhun are Alladhina. The Rasikhun are the ones Alladhina yaquluna, they say again, they're speaking to Allah. Notice again, the firm and established people talk to Allah, never ever forget and never ever fall short on thinking that the dua is anything short of being the weapon of the believer. A dua is the weapon of the believer, talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with siddiq, talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, telling Him about your problems, telling Him about what you require, telling Him Jalla Jalal about what you desire, telling Him Jalla Jalaluhu about how you submit to Him Jalla Jalaluhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who speak to Him Jalla Jalaluhu. The people established are the ones who say, يقولون, they say, رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا آمَنَّا. They tell Allah, يَا رَبَّنَا, we are the ones who believe. إِنَّنَا, for sure, indeed, we are the ones who truly and fully believe. فَغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا, so forgive us of our sins. فَغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ, forgive us of our sins, Ya Allah, and protect us from the adab of the annar. protect us from the punishment of the fire. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to tell you about what their traits are like further, what they are like, what's the behavior like. Remember, we went back to kada'bi ali fir'aun, what the behavior of fir'aun, wa min qablihim kada'bi ali fir'aun wa min qablihim, and the behavior of the people of Ad and Thamud and so on and so forth, is that now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reflects back and tells us what the behavior of the people who are rasikhun are, the people who speak to Allah Jalla Jalal in trueness and in with transparency, the people that speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, As-Sabirina was-Sadiqina والقانتين والمنفقين والمستغفرين بالأسحار الله أكبر ولله الحمد. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst these people. These are the traits, really, 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 these are the traits that we need to have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we look at it on a whole, this is what the Ramadan is all about, truly speaking, is that the Ramadan is here to, it's a 30-day school of what did we termed it before? Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala sayyidina. It's a 30-day crash course. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi. It's a 30-day crash course on bettering the self, ridding yourself of yourself and moving from yourself, making a hijrah towards the Muhammadan self. From eating all the time to eating less. Talking all the time to talking less. Less ibadah to more ibadah. Less presence with Allah to more presence with Allah. Less sleeping too much to more of being awake. Here it says, bil ashar, wal mustaghfirina bil ashar. Those who seek the forgiveness of Allah, bil ashar. In quiet, not only quiet during the day, but remember that the most quiet time is the time at night. Your times of Taraweeh, when the sun has set and things have gone down and things have calmed down, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا. The layl is a covering, and a covering for al-mu'mineen. وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا. A covering for the mu'mineen, where things calmed down. And things, your ma'aish and your aish, your life and things, daily life and so on, had calmed down, and we had made the nighttime a covering for you. We made it a libas for you, that you may take some rest and respite and go back and spend your time of your ashar and your time of your tranquility and peace and connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus we have the Taraweeh prayer. The Taraweeh prayer is from the Tarweeh is to basically take rest and relax and so on, and a step up from that, obviously, as you all know and will experience, especially in this month and out of this month, is the time of the Tahajjud, the latter parts of the night and so on, where everyone else is taking rest in their beds, where you take your rest on the Musallah, or wherever else you are, and connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and speak to Him again, Jalla Jalaluhu, and make qiyam in front of Him, Jalla Jalaluhu, and experience this. Ramadan is a 30-day crash course pushing you towards these traits, pushing you towards these kind of behaviors, and thus you move away from yourself, moving closer to the Muhammadan self, who is as-sabir, as-sadiq. There was no one that had more sabr than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's no one that had more saduq than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one that had more transparency, I like to call it, than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wal qanitina and so on, oft returning to Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. What better way to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than in those last moments of the nights and so on, and being alone with Him Jalla Jalaluhu. Truly speaking, الصابرين والصادقين والقانتين والمنفقين والمستغفرين بالأسحار. These are the people of sabr, the people of transparency, of course, with Allah and what's placed in front of them and what they experience in their lives and so on and so forth. The people of sabr, the people of transparency with Allah, the people who are always content, and thus always referring back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in humility, really, because of how content they are. Al-Mufassir here calls al-qanitin al-muti'in wal-musallin and so on. I just want to see that I'm not missing any more of what the Mufassir says here, rahimahumullah ajma'in. على المدحين وإن شئت أخفتهما على النعت يعني الصابرين في أدائنا نعم الصابرين people of sabr in all of the affairs in the affairs of what's permitted and what's not permitted, the people of obedience in what's permitted and not permitted, being obedient with patience and people who have siddiq and transparency in their iman and the transparency of the approach of how they do things for Allah, doing it not only for Allah but doing it for Allah with Allah. And I suppose that's basically the difference between people who have different levels of siddiq and transparency. Obviously the greater scholars have mentioned much on those, but these are the darajat and so on, maratib al-siddiq, etc., and so on and so forth. Wal-qanitina wal-munfiqina, the people who spend in the way of Allah and spend in the obedience of Allah, for Allah, with Allah, by Allah, etc. Wal-mustaghfirina bil-ashar, is that those people who seek the forgiveness of Allah at all times, and seeking the forgiveness of Allah fil-ashar, yani fi-sihar, in quietness, meaning their moments of intricate intimacy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeking forgiveness from Him, Jalla Jalaluhu. Seeking forgiveness from whom? Seeking forgiveness from Bismillahi Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Seeking forgiveness from none other than Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Jalla Jalaluhu. Naam, wallahu ta'ala a'lam. It's a little bit, there's obviously more in that ayah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Shahidallahu annahu la ilaha illa huwa wal malaikatu wa ulul ilm qa'iman bil qist. La ilaha illa huwa al azizul hakim. Sadaqallahu al-azim. It's a bit of a long one, but Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qawluhu ta'ala, Shahidallahu annahu la ilaha illahu. Shahida is from the Shahada, of course. The Shahada, Shuhud, a witnessing. And while we're on that, on witnessing, that's why you call the person that's passed away, on that's been killed on the battlefield, and so on, a Shaheed. Shaheed, why? Because that person is a Shaheed, from Shahada, Shahada, Shaheed, witnessing the hereafter already. That's why that person is called a Shaheed. Thus, it's a witnessing. Witness, who's witnessing? What are they witnessing? Shaheed Allah. Allah witnesses. Annahu la ilaha illa huwa wal malaikatu. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself stands as witness. That annahu la ilaha illa hu, la ilaha illa hu, what did we say here? Wal malaikatu wa ulul ilm, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, Allah is the one who witnesses that la ilaha illa hu wal malaikatu wa ulul ilm. And here again, we take the witnessing and we look at the level of the amount of weight that scholarship holds, and the amount of weight even knowledge holds, and so on, which we'll get to just now. I just wanted to go back to the word of shahida, shahidallah, and the shahada that we obviously all have to make tashheed of the shahada. Make the shahud of the shahada, annahu la ilaha illahu, in order to be Muslim, in order to be a Muslim and mu'min and working your way up, is that you need to have taken the shahada. Be witness, annahu la ilaha illahu. And this is very important for us, because the shahada entails ashhadu, a witnessing, a shahada being a witnessing, you witnessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or kama qal sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith Jibreel, as you might all know, inshallah, is that to you know, the different maratib of Islam, Iman and Ihsan and so on, eventually arriving at Ihsan, a higher level, and ta'bud Allah ka annaka tarahu fa illam takun tarahu fa innahu yarak, to worship Allah as if you are seeing Him. Notice a witnessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fi kulli lahzatin abada, in witnessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every step you take and in every move you make. Notice that it's never a case of aqulu la ilaha illallah wa anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, but it's ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, is that I don't, it's not aqulu la ilaha illallah, it's not I say la ilaha illallah, but instead it's I witness la ilaha illallah. And saying la ilaha illallah is a very easy thing, because we can always do a lot of stuff that we can say with our lips and our using our vocal cords and so on and so forth, but rather it's a witnessing that you would see through behavior of people, as I've mentioned earlier, the conduct of people and the behavior of people. And over and above all of that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself had mentioned كَدَأْبِ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, their behavior. And thus there's a difference between those who يَقُولُونَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ and those who يَشْهَدُونَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Major difference. People who just say and do the as our Shaykh said, Muhammad al-Nainawi rahimahullah wa rahimahumullahu ajma'in, said that people do a lip service. This is a lip service. يَقُولُونَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, they just say the la ilaha illallah, and thus they said it, and that's all you'll ever hear is أَشْهَدُ is أَقُولُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ أَقُولُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Truly speaking, you hear أَقُولُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ from the actions in their behavior, but the actions in their behavior are the contrary to أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And a person with high conduct and a person with high moral values and so on and so forth, and you see it in this person, this is a person who is true to ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, because indeed yashhadu an la ilaha illallah, he witnesses that there is no lord but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, witnesses this by his conduct, by his mannerisms, by his way of dealing with people, by his way of dealing with his family and so on and so forth. So the claim of shahada is very easy versus the reality of witnessing la ilaha illallah. And you are not Muslim if you don't truly witness la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. And I think we take a quick moment to just renew, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said in a hadith, جددوا إيمانكم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Back to the ayah. شهد الله أنه لا إله إلا هو. Allah bears witness that there is no إله but Allah. وملائكته وأولو العلم. Allah bears witness that there is no, that la ilaha illallah, and the malaika, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created them for this. Obviously they're infallible, they won't make this mistake, they can't fall short of this. Is that the malaika, the ma'asumeen, al malaika, they also bear witness. But look at the grandeur of this affair. It's Allah and the angels. Allah and His angels bear witness. La ilaha illahu. وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here then, also the people of ilm, the people who have idraq of ilm. Idraq is la adraka, if you to make idraq of something is to catch something in conceptualizing something, fully understanding something, witnessing something. You can only witness something if you're able to really conceptualize it, understand it, and so on. And thus those people the people who are, let's say, الراسخون of la ilaha illallah, are the people who are the people of ilm. That's why they witness la ilaha illallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already elevated their ranks and even mentions them amongst Himself and His malaika, the ulul ilm, the people who witness. And what a great gift this is, to be the people who truly witness, notice, not the people who speak about it and who claim it, and the talkers. They've got to walk the walk and not only talk the talk. Walk the walk how? By your akhlaq. That's the akhlaq and the characteristics and the character of none other than Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And another reminder here for especially our women folk, but us as an ummah in its entirety, is that the witnessing of La ilaha illallah is the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the character of the part of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our beloved mother, Sayyida Fatima al-Batul radiallahu anha, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our love for his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for our mother, and our respect and our submission to our mother Fatima radiallahu anha, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله. We obviously pause there until the next session on the tafsir of Imam al-Baghawi, and we move on then with the tasawwuf aspect of things, speaking of bettering our character and trying to follow the character of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Obviously just trying to polish ourselves through the ihsan, whether you call it tasawwuf or you call it ihsan. All of tasawwuf is tazkiyah and ihsan in its entirety, as labeled as by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ihsan. أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه. We move over to Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah, who had done immense works on this really, which inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the benefit of working through his works and benefit from this, because all of the work of Imam al-Ghazali that obviously pushes us to being our better selves, ultimately pushes us towards being closer to the character of none other than Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa alihi. So last week we had begun with the seven limbs that Imam al-Ghazali speaks about that need to be protected and polished in order to attain closeness to Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. We had begun with the eye, which was the first. أَمَّا الْعَيْنِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ فَإِنَّمَا خُلِقَتْ لَكَ لِتَهْتَدِيَ بِهَا فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ وَتَسْتَعِينَ بِهَا فِي الْحَاجَاتِ وَتَنْظُرُ إِلَى عَجَائِبِ مَلَكُوتِ الْأَرْضِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ وَتَعْتَبِرَ بِهَا فِيهَا مِنَ الْآيَاتِ. Is that the ayah? I just want to recap from that, so that we could sort of just get back to the old drawing board really. أَمَّا الْعَيْنِ, he says, rahimahullah, about the eye, is that know that the eye was created for you to navigate your way in the dark, and the eye was created for you to fulfill your affairs and your needs and requirements and so on, to give you a tool of navigation through your days and through your nights, fulfilling your affairs, fulfilling your ibadat, your whatever ritualistic things you need to complete and so on and so forth, be it of ibadah or dedicatedly so, or out of that, not to mention that you need to be using your eye, or it's created rather, for purposes of your eye has been created for purposes of he mentioned Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi, was looking at the heavens and the earth and identifying and then resonating, using it to identify and then recognize and resonating well with the ayat of Allahu Jalla Jalaluhu fil ard. And then he said fahfadha an thalatha, to protect the eye from three things. Look at number one, looking at something, looking at ghayr mahram, and this is a very weighty thing, looking at ghayr mahram. As we all know, these things that we'd come across now, some of them are almost direct channels to the heart, and thus they're very weighty. فَحْفَظْهَا عَنْ ثَلَاثَ, protect the eyes from three, from looking at other than at someone who is not your mahram, looking at or looking at things, nice things, beautiful things with desire, looking at beautiful things with desire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us, a very weighty thing that. And looking at a Muslim with an eye of belittling a Muslim. Number three was, or to look at and see, using your eye again as a tool for seeing and recognizing faults of others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. In which he says, then about the ear, he moves over to the ear. So this is the second sort of limb that Imam al-Ghazali speaks about. وَأَمَّا الْأُذُنُ وَأَمَّا الْأُذُنُ فَحْفَظْهَا عَنْ تُظْهِيَ بِهَا إِلَى الْبَدْعَةِ الْغِيبَةِ أَوِ الْفُحْشِ أَوِ الْخَوْضِ فِي الْبَاطِلِ أَوِ ذِكْرِ الْمَسَاوِئِ النَّاسِ فَإِنَّمَا خُلِقَتْ لَكَ لِتَسْمَعَ بِهَا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَسُنَّةُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَحِكْمَةَ أَوْلِيَائِهِ وَتَتَوَصَّلَ بِهَا إِلَى إِسْتِفَادَةِ الْعِلْمِ لِتَنَالَ بِهَا الْمُلْكَ الْمُقِيمَ وَالنَّعِيمِ الدَّائِمِ. He says, Rahimahullah, is that know that your ear then needs to be protected from listening to things that are innovated in the deen and so on and so forth. More specifically, so listening to people who would tell you things that take you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regards to tawheed and so on and so forth. And then other than that, obviously ghaiba and nanima and fahsha, these kinds of things that are backbiting, and not only backbiting but slander as well. The difference between the two is that backbiting is to speak ill of someone even though it be the truth, and slander is obviously making something up about someone. So the ear needs to be protected from the listening to these kinds of things, and listening to things that have been graded bid'ah in the deen. And also basically it's an indulgence of it. You need to protect your ears from it be using it to indulge in let's say listening to really unnecessary talk. I would actually like to use unnecessary talk, because a lot of talk that actually happens in the sort of entire scope of what people speak about and need to speak about, people have really lost the basic etiquette and the basic characteristic. And it seems that though it has had to become a skill actually to be short and sweet, when this was a natural phenomenon of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you speak short and sweet, and that you speak only what needs to be spoken, not too long, not too short. Be short and to the point, be straight and to the point, and speak things of meaningfulness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and grant us this characteristic of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and especially in this month, grant us all of these characteristics that we're looking forward to obtaining and acquiring bi-ithnillah. Is that listening to unnecessary talk, and listening to unnecessary talk obviously under that falls what he says, dhikri masawi in nas, is listening to the faults of others. Be careful and be very, very careful of this, and that it could be the faults of others and so on. But we'll come to what Imam al-Ghazali actually says later on, and also at other parts of the Ihya ul-Ulumuddin, in which he says, and said something somewhere along the line, I can't pinpoint where it was, in that he said that you need to tell yourself and convince yourself to remember the point that if you have eyes to remember the faults of others, know that every other person has eyes as well, and thus they will have the eyes to recognize your faults. So forget about the faults of others and rather look at your own faults. فَإِنَّمَا خُلِقَتْ the ears, for sure then, know that the ears were created instead to listen to the Qur'an, Kitab Allah, to listen to the riwayat and the narrations of the prophetic tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the hikmah, listen to the wisdoms, and listen to take lessons from the wisdoms of the awliya of Allah and the great scholars and the great teachers in the deen, and to take this and use it towards benefit. Listen to the correct things. Take benefit. How? By listening to the pleas of people, listening to people, listening to your parents. Obviously, the greatest, listening to the Quran, listening to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. لِتَنَالَ بِهَا الْمُلْكَ الْمُقِيمُ وَالنَّعِيمَ الدَّائِمِ. In order that you will use this to propel yourself to an eternal bliss. Use this as a tool to propel yourself towards an eternal bliss. It's a case of it's a simpler case of leaving off the negative capabilities and using it only for the positives, which is what it was created for in the first place. فَإِذَا أَصْغَيْتَ بِهَا إِلَى شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْمَكَارِهِ, and if you continue in using it for work, for going towards what is disliked, which is makruh min al-makarihi, sara ma kana laka alayk. Allahu Akbar. He says, rahimahumullah, he says, then what was for you, as is with all of the other limbs, we know he mentioned in last week's class that it becomes ghayatul tughyan, is that you use the limbs and the ni'am of the limbs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you, you use these ni'am not to go towards Allah, but you use these ni'am to go against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by going against what He subhanahu wa ta'ala had instructed you. And the instruction, of course, is to obey certain things and be obedient in a certain way. And obviously falling out of that would then be disobedient. And thus he says, what was for you, the ear which you would have used, which would have then made shahada for you, yawmul qiyamah, would now make shahada not for you, but make shahada against you. Mathalan, your ears can make shahada in saying, Ya Allah, this person used my ears to listen to ghibah and nanima, and to listen to all sorts of wrong things, things of fahsha and so on, and ma'asi. But instead he used it to do this instead of listening to the Quran, instead of using me to listen to the Quran. He says also, وَانْقَلَبَ مَا كَانَ سَبَبَ فَوْزِكَ فَصَارَ سَبَبَ حَلَاكِكَ, is that this that was supposed to, as I've mentioned, propel you towards a good akhirah. Here he says فَوْزِكَ, your victory, which is obviously a good afterlife. What was supposed to be a means of you attaining victory has now in qalaba, it's turned around, it's actually flipped over. If you don't use it correctly, you don't use the ni'am of Allah Jalla Jalaluhu correctly, this ni'mah then flips over from being your victory to being your complete destruction. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. He says, وَهَذَا غَايَةُ الْخُسْرَانِ, is that this flipping over from what was a ni'am turning over to a complete destruction for you, what was supposed to be your vehicle of attaining full and complete victory, has now just become none other than a tool of self-destruction. This is indeed the height or the epitome of loss, of being a loser. وَلَا تَذُنَّنَّ إِنَّ الْإِثْمَ إِثْمَ يَخْتَصُ بِهِ الْقَائِلُ دُونَ الْمُسْتَمِعِ يَا سَلَامُ, in which he says, and don't think for a moment that the sin falls upon only the person who says the ill thing, who says the misdeed, who says the ghibah and the nanima and so on, but rather the sin falls upon both the speaker as well as the listener to that. And of course, you can't listen without your ears. The tool for that are the ears, and thus he mentioned that under here. فَفِي الْخَبْرِ إِنَّ الْمُسْتَمِعَ شَرِيقُ الْقَائِلِ, for sure and surely the listener is the partner of the one who speaks, meaning if you permit listening to it, you have taken a share and you have taken partnership in what the speaker is saying. Allahu ta'ala a'lam, and protect us from that. Wa amma al-lisan, in it number 3 is the tongue. Wa amma al-lisan, فَإِنَّمَا خُلِقَ لَكَ لِتُكْثِرَ بِهِ ذِكْرَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَتِلَاوَةَ كِتَابِهِ وَتُرْشِدَ بِهِ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى إِلَى طَرِيقِهِ وَتُذْهِرَ بِهِمَا فِي ضَمِيرِكَ مِنْ حَاجَاتِكَ دِينِكَ مِنْ حَاجَاتِ دِينِكَ وَدُنْيَاكَ. He says about the tongue then, number three out of 7 that we're speaking about the tongue. Know that the tongue was created for كَثْرَةِ الذِّكْرِ, لِتُكْثِرَ الذِّكْرَ بِهِكَ ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ لِكَثْرَةِ الذِّكْرِ, يعني it's for a lot of dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reading Al-Quran, even reading the prophetic traditions, the reading the a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are kathrati dhikr. So, and your obviously your other adhkar and your other wada'if and awrad and so on and so forth. This is what your lisan, this is what your tongue has been created for, and for you to converse and again navigate your way in the dunya for what you need to do, what you need to be completing, all of your umur and your hajat, your needs and your affairs and so on and so on. It guides you and it's a way of navigating your way through this life using it as a tool. This is what it's been created for. And it's also been created for you to, in order for you to at times articulate the batin and make it zahir. Subhanallah. I find this amazing, in which obviously our ulama and our scholars have obviously taught us that if you want to look at what's in a person's heart, you need to look at what's on his tongue. And you need to listen to his words, and a person's words will tell you what's in their heart. And here Imam al-Ghazali obviously reaffirms that is the reality of things, is that he says that the tongue has been created for a person to make zahir, to make explicit what is actually implicit and on the inside. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purify our hearts and our minds, bodies and souls, that we may have beautiful tongues and speak words of beauty only. And the best words of beauty are to recite the Quran, and the best other words of beauty are to be sending praise and peace, blessings and salutations upon Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. فإذا استعملت لغير ما خلق لك فقد كفرت بنعمة الله وهو أغلب أعضائك عليك وعلى سائر الخلق. And if you use it for other than what it was created, then indeed you have denied this ni'mah of Allah, as is with the rest of the limbs again. And this is the most in testifying that that your limbs can do against you, obviously your tongue, because your tongue is the limb of speaking. It speaks, it articulates, it can thus testify. If you ever needed to testify, if you ever needed to speak, you're unable to do so without your tongue. What a ni'mah it is. And this is the most able and most capable of testifying. And this is the one that will testify the most against you or for you. Yawmul Qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from our limbs testifying against us and only testify for us that we did act in his obedience, Jalla Jalaluhu, using all of them. وَلَا يَكُبُّ النَّاسُ فِي النَّارِ عَلَى عَلَى مَنَاخِرِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدِ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ فَاسْتَظْهِرْ عَلَيْهِ بِغَايَةِ قُوَّتِكَ حَتَّى لَا يَكُبَّكَ فِي قَعْرِ جَهَنَّمَ فِي الْحَدِيثِ إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ يَتَكَلَّمُ بِكَلِمَةٍ مِنَ And he says, make clear upon it that all of your might and all of your power, with all of your might and all of your power, that you take full control of your tongue, or else you will end up in Al Jahannam. Fafil Hadith is, as is in the prophetic tradition, as the Prophet says, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَتَكَلَّمُ بِكَلِمَتِهِ فَيَهْوِي بِهَا فِي جَهَنَّمَ سَبْعِينَ خَرِيفًا. Allah, in the Prophet ﷺ says that surely a man will speak one word. A man surely will speak one word, and with that word he will be dropped 70 levels in Jahannam, dropped into the Jahannam 70 levels low, or to sort of the 70, it's not even level at a time, or two levels, or three levels at a time. It's one word that's spoken by the tongue, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, one word that can cause you to be thrown into the fire of the Jahannam, and it will each of these words will earn him an excess of an increase in the Jahannam, obviously, by 70 levels. وَقُتِلَ شَهِيدٌ فِي الْمَعْرَكَةِ فَقَالَ قَائِلٌ هَنِيئًا لَهُ الْجَنَّةَ قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ in that people passed by the graves and so on, people passed by after a battle, people passed by a shaheed, and some of the Sahaba said that, oh, what a great position this person is in, for him is Jannah because he is a shaheed. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ كَانَ يَتَكَلَّمُ فِي مَا لَا يَعْنِيهِ وَيَبْخَلُ فِي مَا يُغْنِيهِ sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sadaqa al-Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They passed by a body that had been killed in battle, and thus the person was a martyr, and they had praised him in saying what a level and what a status and what stature he must have, in that he must be granted Jannah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had gone against this, saying, how do you know that perhaps he was one who spoke about what had nothing to do with him, who spoke about what had not concerned him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is an emphasis that we put on the tongue, though it's a limb, and some say it's a muscle that needs to be exercised all the time, sharing all sorts of different opinions and so on and so forth and so on and so forth. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, min husni islamil mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'ni. Sadaqa ar-rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. From the beauty of one's iman, the beauty of one's iman, i.e., in other words, meaning that a person cannot have full beauty in their iman, might not have any beauty in their iman if they had not abided by this, tarkuhu ma la ya'ni, is that they might not have that full beauty in their iman if they tend to exercise and mind what is not their business, and they don't leave off that which does not concern them. Sadaqa ar-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From the beauty of one's Islam is leaving off of that which does not concern him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach us that in this month. Ameena ya rabbal alameen. فَحْفَظْ لِسَانِكَ مِنْ ثَمَانِيَ أَشْيَاءَ. Protect your tongue from eight things. Al-awwal, the first of them is lying. Protect your tongue from lying. Protect your tongue from lying, from lying, whether it be serious lies or whether it be lying in joking. وَلَا تُعَوِّدْ نَفْسَكَ الْكَذِبَ هَزْلًا. And don't do this, and don't partake of lying, even when joking, though you see it light, but it leads to serious lying, and it leads to, basically everything starts off small, as we all know. All of the even the haram may start off within the boundaries of halal, and they move further and further over into gray areas, and then eventually a person may tread off the path into performing haram actions and haram deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. Thus Imam al-Ghazali here says, even if it be al-hazl, even if it be something small, and even if it be joking and in jest, don't lie even in jest and jokes. فَالْكِذْبُ مِنْ أُمَّهَاتِ الْكَبَائِرِ. And lying is from amongst the biggest of the bigger sins. ثُمَّ إِنَّكَ إِذَا عُرِفْتَ بِذَلِكَ سَقَطَتِ الثَّقَةُ ثِقَةُ بِقَوْلِكَ وَتَسْتَدْرِيكَ الْعَيْنُ وَتَسْتَحْقِرُكَ. Is that and if you are joking all the time, and whether you may be lying, even small lying all the time and so on, if you do this all the time, it's the kind of thing that even though people know that you're joking and people know that you're lying in joking, Imam al-Ghazali says that this year you need to come to know in reality, doing this and basically speaking unnecessarily all the time, people begin to feel it, people know it and begin to know it more and more, and thus they don't really take you seriously, and thus you become none other than the joke itself, and people then take you for a joke, and people then don't take you very seriously. So it's very important to take on the prophetic sunnah of speaking short and sweet and not lying, even if it's not so serious. He then says, rahimahullah, is that if you want to know qubha kadhibi min nafsik, if you want to know the bad of the lying and so on for yourself, and you want to see it for yourself, and you want to witness it yourself, then look at someone else who actually does that, in order that you may take a lesson from it, only that you may take a lesson from it. Look at the person who does it, who's always jumping around, joking around and so on, unnecessarily all the time on a non-stop basis, talking unnecessarily, whether they're being serious or not. We often come across people who just need to talk, and they just need to have the mic in their hands at all times and at all occasions, needing to be making announcements all the time. We all know that one person, or we all know that one MC, in a sense, that tends to do this all the time. You'll notice that people don't always take that person very seriously. And Imam al-Ghazali says, if you need to take lesson and to take heed from this, then look at that person and notice and realize that that is how you will end up looking if you're going to continue with that kind of behavior. He says also that you can look at this, you can take this approach to look at every other sort of fault and behavior, or ill behavior rather, because فَإِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي قَبْحَ عُيُوبِكَ مِن نَفْسِكَ بَلْ مِن غَيْرِكَ. He says, because you would never be able to see your own faults, but only you'd naturally be able to see the faults of others. So if you see that, you can observe it and take lessons from it. Remember, don't look down upon anyone, as he's mentioned before this. You're not supposed to use the eye for that, but rather to take lessons from this. And perhaps we could also say that in order to acquire a better adab with Allah, and to be able to acquire better mannerisms and etiquette, perhaps that's from the ayat of Allah that you can learn how it might look if you had to behave as is seen out there. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, and Allah protect us. Athani, the second of the eight of your tongue that you need to protect your tongue from, is al-khulfu fil wa'd, is going against your word and breaking your promises, not fulfilling your promise, except under the conditions of if you are forced to do so. For qala an-nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a prophetic tradition, thalathun man kunna fihi thalathun man kunna fihi فهو منافق وإن صام وصلى ومن إذا حدث كذب وإذا وعد أخلف وإذا أؤتمن خان. In the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, three people of which you see in them, they are a munafiq, even though they might fast and they might even make their salah, is that when they speak they lie, and when they make a promise they break their promise, and when they are given a trust they break the trust. Number three out of the eight, is ghibah. And ghibah, obviously, as I've mentioned at the beginning of the lesson, is backbiting, speaking about someone, something that they might not like, be they present or not present. Even if they're present, it's regarded as ghibah. If they don't like it, never say that intentionally. احفظ لسانك من الغيبة فالغيبة أشد من ثلاثين زينة في الإسلام زانية في الإسلام كذلك الخبر. وَمَعْنَا الْغِيبَ أَن تَذْكُرَ إِنسَانًا. And here he also gives a description, as I've mentioned now, but he gives the the definition again in Arabic, of course. That's a bit really lengthy in that. I'll just move on from that. We can skip that. The fourth one then is الرابع المراء والجدال ومناشقة الناس في الكلام. يا سلام. This is another thing, obviously, that the Ramadan will help us and assist us so much with, is persistency in argumentation and back and forth sort of conversation, trying to prove a point really with annas. A lot of back and forth conversing, a lot of debating going on, a lot of I would say rather bickering going on, you know, as we know, between people who think they have ilm, but in actual fact they only have information and they have no hikmah and so on. They end up playing a game of mental tennis with you, and they end up playing tennis with you with regards to arguments and points they want to put forth and so on and so forth. The persistency of wanting to prove themselves, or even our persistency of wanting to prove ourselves correct, even though you have the correct answer, and even though you are fully and completely 100%, if that ends up being a tennis match, know that you need to protect your tongue from persistency, and persistent arguing and again, like I said, bickering and so on and so forth is what Imam al-Ghazali mentions here. Number 5 out of 8, he says, Tazkiyatun nafs. فَقَدْ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فلا تزكوا أنفسكم هو أعلم بمن اتقى. Is that protect your tongue, in that you need to perform tazkiyatun nafs, is that you need to purify yourself. You need to purify yourself in order to attain taqwa. That's in relation to what the ayah presented here is. فَلَاتُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. It's obviously an open and plain, it's quite simple, even though not many people might realize the weight and the seriousness of this. Is the بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. To translate the ayah in an approximate meaning is, don't boast about yourselves, don't be haughty about yourselves, don't be proud about yourselves, and I like the word boast. Don't boast and don't give yourselves great stature. هو أعلم بمن اتقى. As we all know, إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم. The ones who are most honored in front of Allah are those who have the greatest taqwa with Allah جل جلاله. Allah grant us taqwa and so on. Ameen ya رب العالمين. So that's don't boast. Don't boast in the slightest, don't boast in the greatest. Don't boast, be it with your statuses on social media, be it in your general conversation and so on and so forth. Again, as we all know, especially now in the season of giving even more, it's always the season of giving for the mu'min, but in the season of giving more now in the Ramadan, don't boast about what you've given. Don't boast about the ibadah that you've made. Don't boast about the salatu tasbih that you might have made. Don't boast about the amount of Quran that you've made, the amount of qira'at al-Quran that you might have read, and so on and so forth, not realizing that the reward thereof and so on could be snatched back away from you because of your boasting alone. Allah protect us from boasting, and protect us from making dhikr of what we might have been able to or enabled to achieve and acquire and perform for him Jalla Jalalu. And it said that some of the hukama, some of the people of wisdom said, or asked rather, were asked, ma as-sidqu al-qabih, and what is the real truth of stupidity? What is true stupidity? And he said, thana'u al-mar'i ala nafsi, is that the praise of oneself is absolutely and full stupidity. That's what the answer of the Shaykh was. فَإِيَّاكَ, he says, Imam al-Ghazali says, فَإِيَّاكَ أَن تَتَعَوَّدَ ذَلِكَ, and it's upon you to beware and to be careful of performing that kind of a thing, self-praise and looking for self-praise. Albeit that you're only praising yourself and it has nothing to do with anyone else, but rather self-praise and giving yourself extra merit or any merit at all, that is. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Interestingly enough, he also says, وَعَلَمْ أَنَّ ذَلِكَ يَنْقُصُ مِنْ قَدْرِكَ عِنْدَ النَّاسِ وَيُجِبُ مَقْتَدَهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. In that Imam al-Ghazali also reminds and mentions here, this is another thing that will decrease people's outlook towards you and ultimately decrease people's respect towards you and their haybah and so on for you, is that your waqar would be somewhat depleted and would diminish amongst people of society and communities and even family and so on, is that people begin to belittle you in their eyes. And truly speaking, it's that you belittle yourself in the eyes of those around you, should you be praising yourself all the time, and should you be looking for self-praise at all. Wallahu a'lam. Number 6 out of 8 is wallahu, is that you need to protect your tongue from cursing and being one who curses while speaking and so on and so forth. أهل الكبير نعم. So it's very important to protect number six out of eight of the protections of the tongue. Imam al-Ghazali says that you focus on not and focus on other than cursing people, cursing things, and speaking in a cursed in a way of cursing things and speaking. We can refer to hate speech as cursing, you know, always having problems with things and always having issues with things, always having issues with people irrespective of who they are, what might have happened in the past. You know, I was just reminded by a Shaykh of ours the other day in a lecture that I was listening to, you know, it doesn't matter what happened in the past, it doesn't matter what the person did in the past, it doesn't matter if it's the uncle that you don't like in the masjid, or if it's the teacher of such and such and so on and so forth, is that if you don't like someone, begin to like them, because you've got to love them for the sake of Allah. And if something happened in the past, you've got to stop living in the past and rather come to the present, because the present is all you own, and the past will never come back. So we don't live with that, with the cursing especially. And why I mentioned that is because a lot of the cursing that tends to happen is cursing that comes from past experience and so on and so forth. Get over the past, polish yourself, get over the past, let go of the past, move on, and do not curse any longer. Don't curse, don't speak don't speak on grounds of cursing, don't speak on grounds of hate speech. For Imam al-Ghazali reminds us here that when you come Yawm al-Qiyamah, you will not be asked about who you cursed and how you cursed them, and you will not be merited and granted merit on how you've cursed people and when you cursed them and why you cursed them and so on and so forth. Rather, and instead, you will be asked directly on how and why you have not protected your heart and your tongue. And again, the passage to the heart and from the heart is the tongue. How had you protected your heart and your tongue, and these limbs will testify either for or against you, the tongue being the most in testification for or against you. ولا تذمن شيئا من خلق الله تعالى فقد كان الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يذم الطعام الرديء قط وكان اذا اشتهى شيئا اكله والى تركه. Oh, very interesting and very important. Here again is the protection of the tongue from cursing and thus criticizing. He almost keeps criticism, obviously that which is not constructive criticism, a negative criticism, he also says, he also includes it under sort of cursing, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he reminds, never ever criticized even distasteful food, and never made that kind of adhkar of it. Allah really protect us and teach us of these. As-sabi' Number 7 out of 8, see our time. Number 7 out of 8 is الدعاء على الخلق. To protect your tongue from making negative du'as and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for negative upon people, for asking Him Jalla Jalaluhu for ill upon people, and so on and so forth. These are one of the things that you need to protect your tongue from, most specifically, in our times and so on. We often tend to think that because this person did this, and because that person did that, and because that happened, and because that happened, we can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do such and such. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced Himself in Al-Quran Al-Kareem, He introduced Himself before the Fatiha even began with Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Thus, don't ask Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim Jalla Jalaluhu to be unjust to people. Don't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim again to be negative towards people and cause ill and harm and hurt upon people. Never use your tongue for this, for indeed if there was anything, you're using this to destruct yourself only, albeit you might think that you are actually making a dua and it might be a good thing. Very negative that is indeed. And in the hadith Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ الْمَظْلُومُ لَيَدْعُو عَلَى ظَالِمِهِ حَتَّى يُكَافِيَهُ ثُمَّ يَبْقَى لِلظَّالِمِ فَضْلٌ عِنْدَهُ يُطَالِبُهُ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Indeed, you will be questioned. The one that is wronged by the dua and so on, would be questioned about it. The one that makes this dua and so on, you will be questioned about these kinds of things. And obviously, if it's Yawm al-Hisab, there's a Yawm al-Hisab day in which the matters need to be brought to complete, to be dissolved and solved and sorted out and so on. Don't use your tongue to make these kinds of du'as. You need to protect your tongue from making these kinds of du'as. We'll just go back to the number 8 out of 8, the last one that is, because of our time. Number 8, Imam al-Ghazali mentions that you need to protect your tongue from is al-mizah wa-sukhriyatu wal-istihza'u bin-nas. That being namely joking too much, or joking out of mockery, let's say. Making jest of people and mocking people, using your tongue to verbalize and make a mockery of people, and belittling people, and basically taking people in jest and so on. Mockery is obviously quite a big deal. We might not realize it, but it's obviously a sickness and a disease of the heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And thus he says, فَحْفَظْ لِسَانَكَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرِيقُ مَاءَ الْوَجْهِ وَيُسْقِطُ مَهَابَةً وَيَسْتَجِرُّ الْوَحْشَةِ وَيُؤْذِي الْقُلُوبَهُ وَمَبْدَأُ الْحَاجَةِ وَتَرَاسُمِ وَمَغْرِسُ الْحِنْكِ وَالْقُلُوبِ فَلَا تُمَازِحْ أَهَدًا. Now he says, don't make a mockery of people, and if you find that someone is making a mockery other than making a mockery around you and so on, you don't answer to that. Someone is even making a mockery of you, you don't answer to that. Do not give a reaction to that. Obviously, we know we are not a reactive people. The mu'min is not reactive, though active and proactive and so on, not reactive. We don't do because people do, we don't say because people say, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taught us by the tradition of in which he was walking with our beloved mother, Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha, wa an abiha radiallahu anhu. They were walking, and people had mocked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, And she had replied to them in mockery, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her, "Ya Aisha, we don't do this, we don't behave like this. You don't need to reply to people who are doing that kind of a thing." And Ya Imam al-Ghazali reminds us to take heed and act within accordance of that account, really. وَأَعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ حَتَّى يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِهِ. Don't be reactive, don't have a reaction, don't answer to that kind of behavior, don't answer in being supportive of that kind of behavior, be they mocking yourself directly or someone else, but instead turn away from it. Turn away from it and turn away from them until the sort of conversation or focus shifts otherwise. In other words, in the bigger picture, do not tolerate it, do not condone it, and do not partake of it at all. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. وَكُنْ مِنَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا يَا سَلَامَ عَلَيْهِ Rahimahullah. He says, and be from amongst those people that when they pass upon, when they pass by vain talk and unnecessary talk, pass by as those people who continue in passing by kiraman, marru kiraman, in a state of nobility, in a state of honor, pass by in full and complete honor, not partaking of the lowly kind of behavior of mockery and jest and making fun of people and things and so on and so forth. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله والحمد لله رب العالمين فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته